Hello, good morning. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Northern Nevada. My name is Nathan Bakken. I use they, them pronouns, and I am UUFNN's Director of Faith Exploration and today's Worship Associate. If today is your first day with us, welcome. If it's your 400th day with us, welcome. And if you've been with us since the very beginning, welcome. Welcome to those of us online via Zoom and on Facebook. Here at UUFNN, we are committed to growing together in love, faith, justice, and joy, and to being a place where all people of all races, abilities, ages, class statuses, immigration statuses, gender identities, sexual orientations, religions, spiritualities, and atheistic understandings can call home and call us a community. May the warmth of this community welcome you on this chilly November morning. And I want to invite you now to greet those around you in a fashion that is both supportive for you and for them. That could be a handshake, that could be a wave, a hug, a high five, or a gentle nod. And I'll bring us back to center with the sound of our singing bowl. And so with that, greet you all with peace.
We gather together this morning, our hearts, minds, bodies, and spirits for a service that we are calling Centering Trans Hope. It's an opportunity to come together, to be together as allies, as those who experience different experiences in their stories. And it's important to acknowledge this morning that as we gather on this particular day, we must acknowledge the act of violence in Colorado Springs last evening perpetrated as an act of hate on the LGBTQ community. And so we're reminded that it is ever more important that we have services like we are having today. It's an opportunity to gather in community, to gather our strength, our comfort, our courage, our resistance, our solidarity, and our being allies. And so it is in that spirit that I'll invite Nathan to light our chalice for us this morning. The most powerful thing that we can do to gain understanding and to stand together is to tell our stories. And that is what we are about this morning. Let us continue being fully present to the opportunities and blessings of the morning.
Hi, everyone. Oh, there I am. Okay.
All of these lines across my face tell you the story of who I am. So many stories of where I've been and how I got to where I am. But these stories don't mean anything when you got no one to tell them to. It's true, I was made for you. I climbed across the mountaintops, swam all across the ocean blue, crossed all the lines and I broke all the rules. Baby, I broke them all for you. Because even when I was flat broke, you made me feel like a million bucks. It's true, I was made for you. You see the smile that's on my mouth. It's hiding the words that don't come out. All of my friends who think I'm blessed, they don't know my head's a mess. No, they don't know who I really am, and they don't know what I've been through like you do. And I was made for you. All of these lines across my face tell you the story of who I am. So many stories of where I've been and how I got to where I am. Oh, but these stories don't mean anything when you got no one to tell them to. It's true, I was made for you. Yeah, it's true that I was made for you.
In telling our stories that we discover that indeed we were made for each other. Connection of hearts and understanding. And it is really our stories, I believe, are the only thing in our world that is ever going to counteract hate, counteract fear, and counteract violence. And so it is a bold, bold move when we tell our stories. It takes a lot of courage. And when someone offers their story, it is a gift. And so we receive it as gift. It's difficult and takes much courage to share our stories with one another. And so I ask you this morning, as Sarah Spence comes to offer her story as gift, that we hold her in love, in courage, in faith, in solidarity. Sarah.
Good morning. Wow, Rosie was great, wasn't she?
Wow, that was really good. Okay, here we go. Good morning, I've been a member of UUFNN since 2019.
Can you hear me? Am I good?
In my first service, I sat right over there, and I was wearing this dress. Am I good? No?
Yeah, just lean right out.
Leaned into it? Yeah. Okay, it's a little bit more of me here. Okay. In my first service, I was wearing this dress, and I was sitting right there. Joanne Culver, if you guys remember her, she did a homily about transgender life. She came in. She was Joe at the time. No one recognized her. Well, some did. I had no idea. That was my first service. So it seems fitting, Philip, that I show you the picture of me when I was a man. That's me. This is me in 1998 after I had come back from Bosnia. I tried for 35 years to hide from myself. A secret that something was different about me. sorry, guys, I'm on estrogen, so give me a second here. I was married 16 years to a wonderful woman that tried to learn how to deal with a cross-dresser as a husband, but it just wouldn't work in her Christian worldview. Beginning in 2007, I lost my wife, my job, my house, my religion, my family, and my gender. Wow, this is harder than I thought.
You got this.
Thanks, Katie. Right, thanks. So, I wouldn't wish this pain on my worst enemy. I was thrown out of the Southern Baptist religion who I had done mission trips for, and I still felt a dedicated Christian, but now I was an abomination. When I met Lisa, wow, this sort of, give me a second. When I met Lisa, I mentioned at the time I was a cross-dresser. And she replied with, interesting. It's a Sagittarius for you, right? She not only had no problem with me as my true self, but she dated me and was open-minded enough to have the man that she had fallen in love with become a totally different gender. It takes a very strong woman to stand next to a man who thinks he's a woman and help hide the change from her own family until the time was right. Wow, this is what estrogen does to you. I could have never have done this transition without her. Sadly, she's in the hospital today. She's got an infected toe, so she might lose the toe, but the good news is that she's on vancomycin and she's probably gonna be okay. So it's been that kind of a week for everybody. Back to where I was. And I hope to get back to her as soon as possible. We had a hand fasting ceremony service in 2011, and due to some complications, she can't get married yet, but when we do, we will do it right here. Thank you. Oh, there goes my makeup. All right. Lisa and I traveled around the country where she followed me without complaint as I went through jobs. I would still lose jobs because I had no confidence in myself. It takes a lot of mental energy being a man when you know in your heart you are a woman. In 2019, I got the job here at Renown as a medical lab scientist. Renown has a calming energy that I think I've gone over a little bit, but Reno has a calming energy, and this whole area with the wards of the mountains and everything that I was drawn to, and I built my own family and brought them here. Would you guys stand up? Casey, my overachieving fighter, Alisa, my brilliant nurse, and Lisa, my beloved, moved here in 2019. Last year, Jesse, my brilliant networker and organizer, joined us completing my LGBT family. I think we could be a Netflix reality show sometimes. We were accepted here at UUFNN, and I love you all, and am overjoyed and grateful to sing in your choir every time I can. On Christmas Day of last year, my supervisor, only 5 years older than me, died of a sudden heart attack. I decided to come out and transition at my job. That was the scariest thing I have ever done to date. Now I am on 300 units of estrogen weekly, and it's turned me from a 54-year-old man to a 14-year-old girl emotionally. Yes, pray for Lisa. All right, Transgender Day of Remembrance, TDOR is what we call it, was started in 1999 by trans advocate Gwendolyn Ann Smith as a vigil to honor the memory of Rita Hester, a trans woman who was killed in 1998. There will be more details about that tonight, but I'm just gonna give you a tiny overview real quick. The vigil commemorated all the transgender people lost to violence since Rita Hester's death and began an important tradition that has become the annual TDOR. Last year, we had over 350 individuals on the list from November 2020 to November 2021. That's whenever we take our count. It will be tonight here.
6:30? 6:30.
And I will be working with Nathan on this service. Why does TDOR matter to an average UU? Besides that, UUFNN is a welcoming congregation, and this ceremony fits at least two of our seven principles. TDOR gives a perspective metric on how fragile our democracy is in regard to those often considered undesirable. My community, particularly the transgender kids, are the canary in the coal mine in the fight for equality in our society. Ask your grandchildren in school if they know a trans person, and the odds are going to be yes. My community has a 41% suicide rating, and it's because Western Judeo-Christian conservative family values culture wants to keep these kids from living as themselves. It is torture. Come to our center, who we sponsor, and if allowed, sit in a transparent class. You will see the parents that are your neighbors that feel that they are caught between their families, the law, and the love for their children. These youth are afraid that they are going to be ostracized from everyone and everything that they hold dear. They are our future. And we must fight for their right to exist from those who are afraid of change and threatened by us. Even with the tragedy in Colorado Springs last night, we must persevere. The change comes from you. I'm not the change, you are. There is hope. Trans people can be productive. I am a scientist and I run the laboratory here at Renown. We are smart, we're very intelligent, but we get knocked out we get knocked out of a lot of job interviews because we show up as ourselves. And I'm telling you right now, I've seen this happen. My friend Joanne has had a terrible time down in Vegas because of all that's been going on, that she shows her true self. You are the change. The fact that I am standing here is a sign that our culture is changing. I look forward to the day that every bathroom and everywhere will have the phrase inclusive. Thank you.
We are entering into the part of our service where we get the opportunity to give. UUFNN, through our offerings, supports local organizations here in Reno, Nevada. This month's Share the Plate is Urban Roots. The mission of Urban Roots is to change the way communities eat and learn through hands-on gardening education. Urban Roots prioritizes historically marginalized populations by targeting Title I schools, nonprofits that serve vulnerable communities, including our Native American population, Head Start, and formerly houseless residents. Our generosity will help enhance this kitchen with teaching space, restrooms, appliances, tables, and teaching materials. Also, many students who participate receive scholarships to defray costs. Your gifts will contribute to that fund as well. You can give through the baskets that will be passed around. For those online, you can text UUFNN at 73256 and follow the instructions that are sent to you. And if you prefer to send a check or cash, you can mail it to our address, 780 Del Monte Lane, Reno, Nevada, 89511, or email Carol at the office at UUFNN if you need help. Let the offering begin. Join me in blessing our offering. To the work of this fellowship, which is helping more people grow in love, faith, justice, and joy, we dedicate ourselves and these our offerings.
The anthem today is sort of a hybrid. We ran out of voices, so you have to sing the melody for most of it. Hope you're okay with that, but please remain seated while you can. Thank you.
Blessed are they whose inward beauty.
Are you feeling the power of story? Are you feeling the power of story to change us? Yes. Gender is more complicated and complex than we ever could have possibly imagined when we were coming up and somebody said, "Is that person a boy or a girl?" It is our responsibility as humans to hear each other's stories into speech and to try to understand not so much with our brains, but with our hearts. Are you with me?
Yes.
So why is this a spiritual issue? Why are we talking about gender and transgender in worship? Because gender is a huge part of who we see ourselves to be. It shapes how we view and move through the world. If we are to love and accept ourselves fully and each other, it's important that we understand the social construct and the science of gender. Why is it a justice issue? It's a justice issue because transgender and gender nonconforming persons, as Sarah said, experience violence and discrimination and poverty in tragically disproportionate numbers and self-harm. We host the transgender memorial service this evening and every November, as we have for a couple of decades here in this place. And we must consider it our spiritual imperative to be safe space. There are not a lot of safe spaces. And we must be one. It is our calling as Unitarian Universalists. It is also our spiritual imperative to learn and embrace and to evolve with the times. With that in mind, I'm going to take just a moment and get us on the same page with a couple of definitions. You good with that? I'm going to take us back to our brains. Sex is the biological anatomy of one's body having to do with a number of chromosomes. Historically, it was thought to define us as male or female, and science now knows it is way more complex and complicated than that, and more about a spectrum than binary. Gender is the way we express ourselves along a continuum of masculine and feminine. It's a social construct. It has to do with roles. It's relational. It's different than our sex. Traditionally, gender was thought to be male or female, and now we're understanding it to be much more fluid, much more of a spectrum. For some, gender and sex are the same, are reflected in the same expression. I was born female. That's the sex that I identify with. Therefore, my definition of my gender is cisgender. For some, gender and sex are different. They cross over, which is the root word trans, crossing over. They're transgender if the biological sex and gender expression is different, if that's the descriptor they choose. Sexual orientation is who a person chooses to love. In short, sex is about biology of the body, gender is about how we express ourselves, sexual orientation is about who we're attracted to, who we love. And when we conflate gender and sex, and gender and sexual orientation, we create confusion. They're not the same. They're different facets of our identities. And partly, we've created that confusion because we have lumped LGBT folks all together as the queer community, which is great in some ways, but it's also created some confusion that has to do with gender. Cultures all over the world have known that gender is not binary. It's not just male or female. This is widely recognized in Southeast Asia and Nigeria and Mexico, Samoa, Thailand, Tonga, Hawaii. Many indigenous Native American cultures recognize many genders other than just two. Millennials report in studies that fully half of them experience gender as a spectrum rather than an either-or proposition. So with that gift, the folks coming up have given us some new definitions. Non-binary genders recognize gender as a spectrum rather than either-or. Gender fluid is someone whose gender identity is fluid and shifts along the spectrum, changing, not static. Gender queer is neither male nor female, but is between or beyond genders or some combination of genders. Are you with me so far? Stay with me. Some folks who reject this notion of two choices of gender and therefore may not feel comfortable expressing gender as male or female choose the pronouns they and them to describe themselves. So much of this, I think, is about limitations of language in our culture. And I think if most of us are honest and self-reflective and introspective, we can admit that probably no one is fully 100% masculine or feminine. We're all some combination, are we not? And so I think that awareness can be helpful in understanding a bit of the complexity and complicatedness that is gender. The very best way is sharing our stories, reading, doing research, being a good ally. And how to be a good ally is understanding that we do not have to understand in order to love. And we do not have to understand or have had the same experience in order to respect. Whenever somebody shares their story, it is a remarkable and amazing gift. And yet, that does not mean that we get to interrogate with questions and work out our stuff with that person. Are you with me still? It is not okay to place marginalized persons in a place of being educator for us, for our own purposes. Okay? It's up to us to educate ourselves in order to be good allies and to work out our stuff ourselves and not at the expense of other people. The world is catching up to what science knows, which brings us to how we can make the world better and safer. And a huge piece of that regarding this issue is understanding that pronouns are a justice issue. Everybody has the right to choose their own pronouns without anybody else questioning or disagreeing with their pronouns. Are we together on that? You know, just a few years ago, it was rare, and it's now commonplace that whenever I register for a conference or a workshop, I'm asked for my name and my gender pronouns. You've experienced that too. It's common and it's everywhere now. Just a few years ago, that was not true. Pronouns are a justice issue because they are an identity issue. It's so important for us to support and be allies, be a safe place, be a place of radical hospitality and extravagant welcome. It is our calling and our spiritual mandate. And so we do that by giving everyone the opportunity to express what their pronouns are. It might seem obvious, and yet we do not assume. For those who choose non-traditional pronouns, it is an act of solidarity and allyship for all of us to choose our pronouns and to identify them on our name tags, or if you're on Zoom, in your name frame. It's always good form to put your pronouns on the name frame whenever we're on Zoom together. And so today, out at the welcome table, there are some index cards. If you need to update your pronouns on your name tag, you fill out a card with your name and your pronouns and leave it at the desk, and they will take care of that for you. And we'll ask you always, when we're on Zoom together, to identify ourselves with our pronouns. Beloveds, this really is all about being in community together, to understand how we can get better and better and better about being in community together, to be safe space. May we continue to be changed by stories. May we continue to be powerful allies. And as Sarah so eloquently called us to, may we be the change we want to see in the world. Blessed be and amen.
How could anyone
deeply you're connected to my soul.
We are entering into the part of our service for prayer and meditation. Hope calls us on, calls us forward, calls us into transformation and challenge and change. Life calls us on, calls us forward. Calls us to meet hope. Hope is not simply joy or optimism. Hope can show up as anger, can show up as resistance, can show up as resilience, can show up in those we are told are on the margins. More than often, hope comes from the margins and challenges inward. As you sit in this moment, I invite you to find the hope in your center. Invite that hope to sit with you. Get curious about what that hope is, what that hope is for, what that hope is inviting you to do and be in this world. As we've heard this morning, hope does not always feel comfortable. Sometimes there is pain. Sometimes hope is that discomfort that leads us to survival, leads us to take big risks, to be uncomfortable, to be vulnerable, to be imperfect. Hope is not a fragile thing, though it is carried in fragile bodies. And more often than not, hope is the thing that carries us when we think we cannot be carried anymore. I invite us to sit in this hope. For it is this hope that reminds us we are the change. We are the resistance. We are the joy and the love and the anger and the grief. It is the hope of this community. It is the hope of ourselves. It is the hope in the wisdom of the trans people in our own community, in the trans people we have yet to invite into this community. It is the hope of those taken from us outside of means of their own. They give us their hope that we might carry it forward. As we bring this prayer and this meditation and this sacred moment to a close, I invite you to place a hand on your heart and raise a hand forward as a reminder that we carry this hope inwards and outwards, and we carry this hope together. Amen. Namaste. Blessed be.
Thank you so much for joining us for our Centering Trans Hope service this morning, whether on Zoom or in person. We're so glad to have you here today. After our service, there is a talk to the board session, and that service will be led by Adrian, our president, in this room, and on Zoom, it will be led by Alicia. And if you want to attend that group on Zoom, you can drop a note into the chat. And you'll be placed in the group in the appropriate room to have a discussion or any questions you have of a board member. If you consider yourself to be on a path to membership with this congregation, we would love to know that. We're in the middle of revamping that process, and with coming back after COVID and doing some, making some changes and revamping, we would love to hear from you if you feel that you are on that path. And you can speak to me about that or Billy Lee. Raise your hand, Billy Lee. And we want to compile a list and move forward together toward that end. And Rosie has an announcement along with Justin and then Nathan.
Hi, we just want to say thank you. Thanks. We just want to say thank you to our UU family for your support during our miscarriage and my surgeries. It was such a blessing. All the food, money donations, people stopping by, saying hello, prayers, mail, emails. We felt so loved and we felt so supported. So thank you from the bottom of our hearts so much.
Yes, thank you. I've never felt so welcome into a community before.
So thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay.
There were books. Just two quick announcements, even before that closing song, which, oops, sorry. So the first announcement, this service this morning is in many ways a two-parter. We have a candlelit vigil tonight at 6:30 in this room. It's going to be an interfaith and intercommunity vigil honoring the trans people who have lost their lives from November of last year to November of this year worldwide. In total, the number is over 400. And in the United States, there's over 70 reported deaths. And so it's gonna be a space of mourning. It'll be a space of reverence. I'm also a firm believer that every function needs food. So there's also gonna be a potluck afterwards with to-go boxes. So if you feel called to come and you want to bring a dish, please. And it's in partnership with Temple Sinai, the Methodist community here in Reno, the Lutheran community, and UNR and our center. So there's going to be a lot of communities coming together to honor this really sacred day. And if you can't come in person, we are streaming it live on our Facebook page. We won't be holding a Zoom room for it, but it will be streaming on the UU FNN Facebook. My other big announcement, if you look to your right, I almost said my left, we are launching our Ribbon of Joy project, which here at UU FNN is when we provide gifts for families in need from WAX, which is an acronym whose name I just forgot out of my head. Women and Children's Center of the Sierras. It is on my piece of paper. It is gonna be led by Sue. Sue, could you raise your hand? And it is gonna be an online version this year. So when you grab that page, it has instructions for you on how to sign up on gifts. We'll be emailing this out in our news blast with all the instructions. And there will be two drop-off times in the month of December, December 12th and the 13th at WAX, where you can drop off your wrapped gifts. As well as if it is difficult to drop off gifts, you can call Sue or email me. And we can arrange a pickup for you. Sue, did I miss anything? Great. And so you can take one of those pieces of paper off the ribbon and carry it with you so you have a physical copy of instructions, and the instructions will be emailed out as well. And if you have questions, talk to Sue or me, and we can hopefully answer whatever you may have. Thank you.
We all have pain, we all have pain.
hope that you've been gifted with something that you needed this morning. Please remain standing in body or spirit for our benedictions. Beloved, how could anyone ever tell you that you are anything less than beautiful? You are beautiful in all of your spectrums. In that knowledge, let us go forth and be healers and changers of our world. Blessed be. Amen. Namaste.